Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Rare Book Room. My name is Kaylin. I'm the event director here. Thanks for joining us on a Sunday night. I'm really excited tonight to welcome John Popper, solo artist and frontman for Blues Traveler, to celebrate and discuss the release of Suck and Blow and other stories I'm not allowed to tell, along with Suck and Blow co-author Dean Budnick, who also serves as the editor-in-chief for the music magazine Relix. Please join me in giving John and Dean a warm welcome.
This crutch. Hey, Sarah, long time no see. I went to high school with her. So you have to bear with this crutch because my leg is healed, but it's not quite functioning yet. So it's fun taking this thing around. Someday I'll be done with these crutches.
All right. So, you know, I was thinking as I was driving in here, this is the moment in time where a lot of high school seniors are finding out, discovering what college they're going to be attending, which sort of leads us to the pivotal moment which starts out our book, in which John literally plays his way into college. So I was wondering if you could just talk a little bit about how all that came about.
Kids, if you're trying to get into college, make sure you have a shirt with a pocket, because then you can fit your harmonica in it. That's the best advice I can give you. I was talking to the dean of the new school who was starting this jazz program, and I'd heard about it from Arnie Lawrence when I was trying to get into Manhattan School of Music during a summer session, and he was this great improvising player, and you'll see in the book he meant a lot to me and taught me a lot about playing. And he said, I'm starting this program over at the new school, and I was thinking that might be a cool option because I had really horrible grades, straight Fs, and then the Manhattan School of Music sent me the 32 bars of Bach I would have to sight read for them as my audition, and I said, well, the new school, huh? That sounds pretty cool. So I'm getting an appointment with the dean, and I'm sitting in his office, and he's looking at my transcripts of straight Fs, and like, I don't know, John, I really don't know how we can get you in. And I had the harmonica in my pocket, and I took it out, and somehow the conversation got on, could you play a little? And I played for him, and he said, well, I guess we can let you in, and I got into the school that way. And I, some voice in the back of my head was like, see, I knew I didn't have to do all that homework. And I was just sort of telling the story to my niece, who's 12, and my sister's behind her going, don't tell her this. And I always have to end the stories with my niece with, don't be like me, I'm a bad example. But, you know, every now and then when my relatives aren't here, I go, yeah, be like me. School? Huh, that's just another angle. Yeah, there's my sister right there. I was just telling her this. That's her. Anyway, is Petra here?
No.
Okay, good. So be like me, everybody.
Well, stepping back, sort of the superhero origin story in terms of that first time.
It was a radioactive harmonica.
That's
yes,
right.
That's right.
Okay. Can you share that account of the moment when you really first played and
Yeah, it's actually on the back of the book, but I'll give you my rendition. I was, again, in high school, and I had really horrible grades, and they were going to send me to remedial school. You know, it was me and all of the troublemakers, which in Princeton meant basically you were African American. So it was me and all the black kids in one class. And they were going to send me to a school for, I don't know what they were going to send me to, but they started talking a little gentler to me, like, it's a school you'll really enjoy and you'll learn things at your pace. And, you know, I could sort of sense that it was a different school, but they tested me, which is part of this process, and found that I was smart. And they, the remedial teacher, Mrs. Smith, said, well, we have to get him connected with something in the school. And they'd heard me playing harmonica around the parking lot, so she got me an audience with our high school band teacher, Mr. Biancasino, and he said, well, we're a big band, we don't really have harmonicas in our band, is there any other instrument you'd like to play? And I was there like, well, I don't know, maybe the trumpet is kind of nice. So great, here's a trumpet, okay, get out of my office. So I've got a shiny trumpet now. And I went to a trumpet teacher, and again, he was telling me how to do it, and I had to read, and I was a terrible reader, and I was sucking at the trumpet. You're supposed to blow into a trumpet, incidentally. And I'm the third string trumpet in the Nassau band, which is the beginner band. Me and a whole bunch of other. Gina's here. Hey, oh, and there's my shrink. Oh my God, Alan Levine is. Oh, it's like a family reunion. And so I'm the third trumpet, and we're playing She Blinded Me with Science, and they're going around the room for solos, and I did my horrible third trumpet solo, and they're going around the room for solo, and I had a harmonica in my trumpet case. I had three of them, and one of them was luckily in the right key. And he says, yeah, try it. And I started playing, and then it really was like that moment in The Natural where they see Robert Redford hit the ball. And suddenly the room got quiet. And the next day I was in the first string band, and the principal's coming to see me play. And from that point on, it kind of started the job I have now. It's been that way ever since. And people around school would even know who I was. And I didn't know who they were. Like, hey, you're the harmonica guy. And be like, hey, you. And it was really, it was changed in that fast a time. It really was kind of a cool, like, what if I'd been sick that day? You know, that would have been interesting.
Well, have you ever given thought to if that hadn't gone down?
If ifs and buts were candy and nuts, you know, I think, what if I'd studied? You know, what if I'd applied myself? You try to never ask those questions. But I think that it was really just this magical moment that I think everybody gets in their life, and mine just happened to be very punctuated. I think it was really cool to, you know, feel like you don't have anything good and then suddenly have it be so brought out. I mean, it was really a stark difference. And I mean, that really was the beginning of me developing social skills, because then I belonged to that band, and that was the first sort of team I belonged to. And that I think is hopefully the age when a lot of people find their thing. And I mean, you were just telling me your son is 11 and building games. You know, that's his thing, and how he found that moment was probably a little more personal or more private. Like, he probably did that on his own. But there's probably that moment coming where he's going to be, like, in front of his peers, and they go, wow, you did that particular thing really well. And it really was just a magical occurrence for me, and I will never forget that day. I mean, how can you? There's so many moments in my life that are like that, though. They were asking me yesterday I was in Long Island, and they were asking me, what's a great moment in the book? You know, like, what's your, always try to get you to say, what's your favorite moment? And, you know, every moment's your favorite when you're having it, you know, or the most incredible. But I remember we're sitting in a patch of clover, and Bob Sheehan, our bass player, reaches down and picks a four-leaf clover. Like, it's nothing. Like, boink, here's a four-leaf clover. And he and I were very competitive. We'd always cut high card to the ace. And we'd both cut aces all the time without looking and act like we were doing this, like we had magical powers or something. But in that moment, he pulls the four-leaf clover, and without even looking, I pulled a five-leaf clover. It was a four-leaf with a little fifth leaf on the stem. And the band's freaking out, because after that, we all lose our composure. We're digging through the clover, you know. I'd love to say that we all like it, but that one look on Bobby's face of having pulled a four-leaf clover and then I just answer him with a five-leaf clover, I'm going to have that forever. You know, it doesn't matter if we got a visual confirmation from other people. He knows it and I know it, and that's the thing that's magic in a way that you can't redeem for cash value, but it lets you know that magic happens when you need it. And the important part is when you pull the five-leaf clover to go, yeah, I meant to do that, you know. Certainly I was like, oh yeah, well shit, that is a five-leaf clover. But then I was like, uh-huh, see, yeah, choke on that.
Well, I imagine there's some analogy in terms of when you're on stage and happen upon something accidentally.
I think that's the nature of improvised music, is you're always trying to make cool moments like that happen. And they're there to make happen if you appreciate them right. You'll play a wrong note or a wrong phrase, and then if you repeat it, then it sounds like you meant to do that, and you can make that into something. The thing that you learn in improvised music is when you mess up, don't see it as messing up, but see it as a change in what you were planning to do, and you go with that change. And then you can make lots of lemonade out of your lemons.
going back, you know, you mentioned your high school band, uh-huh. and your high school band teacher was...
Yeah, Mr. Biancasino.
Was in some way...
He was the inspiration for the Whiplash movie. And I remember when the Whiplash movie was coming out, the ads, you'd hear Whiplash, and he beat that song into us so thoroughly. And it's this song written by this guy named Hank Levy, who likes to write obtuse time signatures for high school and college bands to play. And this one was in 14/8. I always thought of it as 7/4, but it's basically the same time signature. And it's dum da da dum da dum da dum da da dum da 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 da. And that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And being in the band, I had to listen to that every day while we worked that out. And the commercial comes on, and it's like da 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 da. And you instantly snap back into like Vietnam mode, like, oh my God, it's Whiplash. And then I look and it's the Whiplash movie. I'm thinking, wow, is that any? And then I heard from Marcus Bleeker, my friend, that's based on Mr. B. And I was like, you're kidding me. And sure enough, they have the Nassau band and the studio band. Nassau is the main street in Princeton. And so that's what it's named for. And studio band was our first string band. And I'll tell you, J.K. Simmons did a great job. It was nothing like Mr. B. I never saw Mr. B slap anybody. He never went full Patton. But, you know, there was a hint of the great Santini, but never that far. But he had it out for drummers, and it was largely because of my friend Marcus and also Brendan. Because before that, Mr. B had consistent jazz drummers in the student body. There were some real Buddy Rich fans and real Xavier Krugak fans and Billy Cobb fans. And my generation, and I mean Marcus, who was in the DJ Logic band with me, and Brendan, they were the first ones who were John Bonham guys, and they played that Led Zeppelin sound. That was the inherent sound, and you can learn the other stuff, but you find that one of these styles is really your life's blood, and that was the first time Mr. B was confronted with rock drummers in his jazz band, so he would punish them as hard as he could, and we'd go over and over these parts, and what they don't show you in the movie, for instance, is that Mr. B eventually would kick them off and he would get on the drums. And watching Mr. B play the drums was the funniest thing, because he would, there'd be that, he wasn't hitting anybody, but you certainly felt that much pressure being a little high school kid, as he would just torment us all with his lectures and you're not getting the part right and all these adages of, you know, the only excuse for missing a gig is your own death. Like he'd say stuff like that. And he would get on the drums and then look utterly ridiculous trying to play the drums with his tongue sticking out. And he couldn't play the drums. So we had to sit there being terrified of him and not laugh at this terrifying man now looking really silly playing the drums. But Mr. B was a lot sweeter than the J.K. Simmons character. And the one thing in that movie that really I'd never seen any band teacher do is set someone up to play the wrong tune and mess it. Because, you know, why are you going to do that? It's just making yourself look bad. He was a great character. He passed in 2002, I want to say. Was that right? 2001 or two. I remember going to his service, but he'd done so many cool things. He had 7 kids, and he lost one of his daughters to cancer. And so every year we would go and play the cancer ward in Pennsylvania, in Philly. And he would do wacky things, like he'd run for mayor of his little town in Pennsylvania. I think it was Tullytown. And we were his campaign band. And so it was kind of fun to, you know, it was clear that there was sort of an unhinged aspect of Tony B. He would do crazy things. He invented an ice cream cone. It's patented. The kind that doesn't drip down your hand, because there's like an ice cream cone within an ice cream cone. And he would go on and on about that patent. And he'd bring like us high school kids in his office and shut the door and go, I don't know, John, I don't know. You know, it's just such a rat race out there just trying to get this stuff done. And then at the same time, he would sell my band amps under the table so he could afford trombones for the trombone section. You know, you had to love that guy. Nothing would keep him down. But maybe the best moment was after high school. Well, there's 2 great moments after high school. One was I come back and he's decided he's going to start a rock band. He was going through a bad time and decided the answer was to be a rock band. And he had a fashion line called TJ Clasher was going to be his rock name, and it was going to be Clasher Fashions. And the idea was half of your outfit was like a tuxedo, and then on this side it was all ripped and tattered because it clashed with itself. That was the whole premise. And you just got to love a band that's thinking of its fashion line first. And I remember the song. We get in there, and this rocking band was, I believe the song was, "As I look into your eyes, I feel love inside." And I'm trying to picture, like, kids liking this. And, you know, and he took me aside. "I'm just thinking about that kid from Detroit who can't afford a ticket and is trying to sing something to his girl that night in the backseat of his car. That's the guy I'm doing this for." Oh, and he also came up with the phrase, "One hit, nobody works." That's what he kept saying to us. "If this thing's a hit, nobody works." It got pretty out there. And invariably, you know, he needed money for this project, and that never happened. But I think the other great time was, this is a few years later, he'd calmed down. You know, we were, all the alumni were sort of calling him Dr. Midlife for a little while there. And then I come back to see him, and he's, "John, I've got this great classical concert at the Newark Music Hall." It was some public place you could rent, and he got an entire symphony orchestra, and I was playing in it. And who do you suppose composed this piece but Hank Levy? So it was another one of these obtuse long, oh, there's Eric Lawrence, Arnie Lawrence. Arnie Lawrence, who got me in the New School, that's his son right there. And, yeah, we'll say again?
You did well.
Oh, thank you, sir. So I listened to the piece once. And there's a section where I guess I'm supposed to improvise. And the kicker is he's got this friend who built a harmonica microphone. Revolutionary new harmonica microphone. This was a really crappy harmonica microphone that people had made before, but to him it was new. And he needed me to play it to help pay for this. Somehow he'd gotten an endorsement. And so next thing I know, like 2 days later, I'm going to this concert, and he's got it's Trenton or Newark, some music hall. And it's just really horrible, my part. I've heard this song twice. And so I go out there to play, and it's just terrible. I'm wrestling through it, trying to sound like I know what I'm doing. I'm not even sure what key it's in, because it's moving through all of these keys, and on a harmonica, that's really hard to do. So I wrestle through it as best I can. And as I go to sit down, the harmonica microphone is attached to the metal music stand, and I'm carrying it with me. So I pulled that music stand down, which knocked over like two other music stands. So, you know, it's very serious, and you play, and you go to take your seat, and clang, 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 clang. And at that point, it was just funny, and it was just another Mr. B moment. You don't know where you're going to go with that guy. It was hysterical. I can't tell you how much fun I've had with him. And a lot of it was because he was such a serious competitor, and he knew about horns, and he knew about the strings. He didn't know anything about the harmonica, so you're listening to, you know, definitely a more real-life version of J.K. Simmons' character, but he's yelling at everybody but you. He didn't know really what to do with me, so I would just sit there, and he'd just point at me, and I'd play. So it was kind of like being in this high-pressure situation, but in sort of a protective bubble. And if you're ever going to be in that situation, I really recommend a protective bubble.
Well, you know, you mentioned playing in his mayoral campaign.
Yes, yeah.
It made me think of one of my favorite sections of the book, in which you visit the White House when the Gore's finally, Gore finally decides that's it.
Yeah,
you can see the election. Then you play
concession party.
Can you talk about that?
That was really fun. You know, we were in town to play Bill Clinton's. He did this thing for Special Olympics, and I got involved with the Shrivers, and we would go to the White House, and we just found out that Al Gore was conceding. So all of these stars were in town. Tom Petty and Bon Jovi went over, and Stevie Wonder, and I mean, just this lineup that was incredible. And of course, my manager Susan Bank had left all of the harmonicas in the basement of the White, or the broom closet. The White House apparently has a broom closet that they were locked in, and you know, she was having her Jackie O moment, like, "Isn't this wonderful?" And she left my harmonicas in the office. So I now have to play on the spat on harmonicas of the opening band. That was pretty grody. And at one point, Stevie Wonder is playing, and he's you know, this big jam's going on. He's like, hey, blues traveler guy, come play with us. I don't have the key harmonica. So now he's blind. So you can't wave at Steve and go, I don't got the key. I had to like walk back up there through the crowd of, you know, rocking people and tap him on the shoulder and go, Stevie, it's blues traveler guy. I don't got that key. And he goes, wait a minute, wait a minute. What key do you have? I don't know, F, I guess. All right, let's do it in F. So they had to move it all to F. And yeah, that was really hysterical. And the capper was at the end of the night. I'm in the elevator with John Bon Jovi, and we have this long elevator ride. And he's like, those fucking bastards stole that election from us. And I got like two floors left with him. And do I tell him that I'm a Republican? Or do I just go along with it? And I thought about it, and I just said, those fucking bastards. And that's how we left it. I had to lie for John Bon Jovi. It was terrible.
Although, you know, I would point out that for a Republican, you just played for Bernie.
Yeah, I know. I'm an avid socialist now. I found that out. Well, can you pretty cool.
Can you talk about that?
Well, my wife, Jordan, she's around here somewhere, and she's back there somewhere. Oh, Pete Shapiro. Oh, there she is. She's a big Bernie supporter, and I like Bernie because he seems to be as genuine as any of the five remaining are. And truthfully, I really love the fervor that's going on in this election, where you are now defined by your choice of five people. And, you know, let's look at the Republicans this year. There's really no choice there. You know, I don't know how everybody's politics is. It's never good to bring up politics, but I think it's safe to say that Trump and Cruz have kind of a tin ear on the social issue thing. Let's just put it that way. A little too hard for me to vote for them, let's say. And I took a test of which candidate are you most aligned with, and actually it's Hillary, or as I like to call her, Hill Dog, because I can't get that South Park episode out of my head. You know, when Hill Dog starts with the Ebonics, it's kind of scary to watch. But I've spent my entire life, you know, demonizing Hill Dog, at least politically. And the truth is, she's a perfectly nice person. I met her, and she's really nice, and got to know. And she took the trouble to learn about Princeton when she was hanging around with us. And she got our drummer's daughter to pose with McDreamy from I'm brain farting. Grey's Anatomy. Thank you. And you know, I see her on TV, and I see her calling Bernie a liar. And it's just weird. Any other subject, but when she starts talking about who's a liar, it's weird. And so I think when I'm the most aligned with Hillary, it's time for some kind of a shakeup, you know, politically, at least in my mind. Just the anarchist in me wants just something different. And I don't know if that's sensible or rational, but a few years ago I tried really getting behind Ron Paul because I'm a libertarian. That really what I am is a libertarian. How that gets played out in a political election pretty much means the libertarians sit there and just sort of talk amongst themselves and get patted on the head. And, you know, I think politics really changed for me at that Ron Paul rally, because they had a pro-choice libertarian. And it used to be that being a libertarian, you were pro-choice. You were sort of, that was kind of an open question. And because Ron Paul happens to be a big pro-lifer, it got very co-opted because Ron says it's wrong. They really changed that. And this pro-choice libertarian gets up and speaks and says, maybe you could look at it as a pro-choice issue from the mom's point of view. It's a property rights issue. Her womb is her property. He was getting booed like they'd brought the least libertarian. It was like this incredible mob viciousness of another libertarian who was suggesting just anything other than the party line. And I just started to back away a little bit and be like, you know, it's not really safe anywhere where there's a mob of people rooting for somebody and hating other people. And I certainly felt that a little bit at the Bernie rally, but they were really nice to us, and we did get a hot dog.
There's a picture of you enjoying a lovely hot dog.
Well, Jordan and I are sitting there, and we were kind of hungry, and we saw this hot dog stand, and her friend who seated us was like, is there anything else you need? And I said, well, you know, they do have a hot dog stand over there. And she went, what do you need? And, you know, I went one ketchup and mustard, and, you know, so we ate the hot dogs while he was talking about the poor. which I just love the irony of. It wasn't even that good a hot dog, but it was a good sort of spiritual hot dog anyway. And I played with this. They needed a band for me to play with, and they found a Green Sky Bluegrass band. And the funniest part to me was Bernie's out there thanking us, and you could tell he didn't know who we were. He goes, "Green Ski Bluegrass Band," and he just called them Green Ski. And I love it. It's like I'm thinking in his mind, it's like a polka band. You know, I love that. And he was very nice. And when you see the speech, he walks right off stage and comes over to Jordan and me. And Jordan's nursing, of course. And it's as though he'd given the speech and went to confer with his experts. And I love that. And then, of course, the next day on Facebook, I was accused on the right of being a traitor and on the left of not being, I'm too much of a fascist to be a socialist, so I didn't earn it. And it's kind of hysterical. I'm a big centrist. I'm convinced it's somewhere in the middle. And the last thing I want to do is proselytize, because when you hear a musician proselytizing politics, you know that we're just digging through the crap, because what the hell do I know about any of this? You guys have as much, probably more information than I do. So really, this election, I'm really debating not voting. You know, I'm trying to think, who can I really just jump in and get behind? And Bernie said some great stuff, but there's still questions I have about how we're going to pay for it. So it's a tough year. I really don't blame anybody on their vote this year, whatever you're going to vote. Even if you vote for Trump, I want people who vote for Trump to at least express their views and not be shouted down as evil. But at the end of the day, I don't want that guy to win. I just want a dialogue. And, you know, it's great to want things, you know.
In terms of Hillary, whose husband was the president, you know.
Yeah.
You once had an encounter with him. Could you?
I've had a few with Bill. And the first time I met him was the night he was being impeached in the House. And it's fun to say to your manager, Dave Fry and I were driving down to D.C., and it's fun to hear this on the radio and go, "To the White House," because we were on our way anyway. And we're at the White House getting ready for the event, and of course some Secret Service person said, "At no point can we ask Bill to sit in, or can he put anything in his mouth?" And so you're like, oh, you know, so you're thinking like this kind of cool little like inside thing. And you see all of these interns, and they really are kind of walking the grounds kind of like hula girls with wreaths of flowers and stuff, just sort of giggling. It kind of was like Hollywood, only time to the power of 10. It was weird and kind of makes you go, well, I see how it could be a temptation, but then why Monica? You know, like what's, you know, you're playing this all out in your head. And all I wanted was to see into the eyes of this man who'd caused all of this trouble. And it was kind of what you would expect. He was exhausted and happy to be alive. He was like, "Hey, how you doing?" You know, and that made sense to me. It was like, you know, he doesn't even know where he is. He's exhausted. He's out on his feet. But Hillary was scary because she was like, she wasn't saying this, but she grabbed my hand firmly, and it was as if to say, "Welcome to my motherfucking house. Yeah, we're open for business. You like the tree? Uh-huh. Every year. Come back anytime." And you really got this feeling, yeah, all right, that's who's driving in this thing. Hey, Janine. Janine's here. My lawyer, Janine. The next time I went to see them for the Special Olympics thing, this was right before the concession party with Al Gore. I'm trying to think of something sort of cute and smarmy I can say without getting ejected, like "Don't let the door hit you in the ass," or "No, that'll get you thrown into jail, you know, if you're in the receiving line." And I'm trying to think of something just a little pithy. And I put my hand in his and I go, "You know, you've humanized the presidency, and I think people are going to remember you very fondly." And he did the double-fisted, like, thing. And, you know, I was expecting that a little bit. I wasn't expecting that to come out of my mouth. I walked away like, where the hell did that come from? But when you meet the most powerful man in the world, I don't care who it is. You know, it could be Barbarossa himself, and you'll walk up to him and think he's somehow nice. You know, and these guys all get there somehow through some sort of charm they exert. And he was a nice guy, and it was touching that he got moved, but what was even creepier was that I moved Hillary. And when you see that concrete face turn into a smile, it reminded me of like when the Grinch's heart grew 3 times its size. So it's like, and it was really kind of weird. Now, the first time I played for the president was with Eric Clapton, and we did, I think Elvis Christmas Time, Pretty Baby. And at the end of the show, I went for it, and I picked him up off the ground and hugged him and wasn't shot by any Secret Service. It pays to make friends with the Secret Service. They were showing me all kinds of cool draw techniques on their guns and stuff. But he giggled like Barney Rubble. He goes, ooh, when you pick him up. So I have that experience to share with you if ever you're wondering what it's like to pick Bill Clinton up physically. But the next year, or the next time I did that, it was in 98, I'm there with B.B. King, and we're doing a song we both thought was inappropriate, Backdoor Santa. And B.B.'s like, are these really the words? You know, and the thing you got to remember is that it's cool meeting the Clintons, but the first time, screw that, it's Eric Clapton. You know, I'm playing with Eric Clapton, and now this is B.B. King. So I'm more in awe of their presence by miles. And I come out to play, we'd done the rehearsal, and we're just standing there, and nobody's doing anything. And I look, and the big chair is empty, and Bill comes running out with the Secret Service from the bathroom. And so I took my moment, and I said, Mr. President, you don't have to run. You can take your time. You're the president. We'll wait for you. And he goes, I was just going to get my harmonica. And for that second, I was Americana. See? When the president knows what you do for a living, that's a fun moment. But recently, they let me, I got to be in his office for, we did that thing for Hillary and Chelsea. And I got to go in his office, and I got to, he has the letter that Einstein wrote to FDR about Oppenheimer. And he has the actual letter. I mean, he's got a really cool collection in that office up in Harlem. And I got to take one of his presidential coins and swap it for one of our, when you play for the military, you get a military coin. And it was really cool to like get a guy who has his own coin. And so that went in the collection. Really nice people. I can't say anything bad about the Clintons. It's just, if I'm not voting for them, it's really about just the way politics are. But I'm sure that they're okay. They've got Beyonce. They really weren't. They weren't calling me anyway. Yeah, that, let that be a lesson to any future candidates. Call me up, or else I'll be working for the other guy.
Fair enough. Well, I sort of steer clear of music questions with the thought that if people had music questions, we can.
It's pretty much all my relatives, so they've heard all this stuff before.
Well, does anyone? Yeah.
Yep.
How much I've been wheelchair fan for a couple of decades.
Well, thanks. And,
love Straight on the Morrow. Probably one of my favorite albums. Right. Justified Thrill. How much did the writing of that particular song, how much that was influenced by
a lot of it, actually. I was wondering where you're going, influenced by, and I was thinking, oh boy, what it was influenced. But that definitely, I was trying to, that reference to the pig on a stick, the pig's head on a stick, there was that. And I was also ripping off a lot of nursery rhymes, like Wink and Blinkin' and Nod, and Sing a Song of 420 Blackbirds Baked in a Pie. And I was just trying to make it sound unhinged. And so the idea was to take a nursery rhyme and make it as dark as I could with a reference. And I'm trying to remember the chorus. I think the idea is like, how else am I supposed to feel given the turmoil of this situation? And I'm trying to remember what the situation was, but it was Sing a Song of 60 Cents, A Pocket Full of Rye. Oh, God. Oh, it's terrible trying to remember words that long ago. But it was, I really just wanted to sort of make a scary fairy tale. If you want to make something scary, take a fairy tale and twist it. You know, a great example, it's not really musical, but 1, 2, Freddy's coming for you. Like, is there anything scary? That's actually scarier than when you see him is like little girls jumping rope in slow motion. There's nothing scarier than that. I think the scariest thing on earth could be well-organized four-year-old twins. Because they just have to go to a hotel in their best Sunday dress and stand next to each other and go, come play with us, Danny. And so I was trying to get that kind of feeling to it. Because all you got to do is take a nursery rhyme and corrupt the hell out of it. And I think that's what I was going for. And trying to put lyrics to the way my band writes sometimes is challenging because they go for some really out there chords. And so like I'll take a very, that's really I think the best thing about Blues Traveler songwriting is they have very strange chords, and I have very simplistic melodies, and you combine the two, and then you get something kind of cool. More often than not. Well, about half the time. Yeah.
Well, you've said, by the way, that that's one of your two favorite Blues Traveler albums.
Straight On Till Morning and Save His Soul. I think the ones on either side of Four were my favorite, because the one before Four was our sound guys producing it, and there's something really natural in the songs there, and it felt like us at being ourselves, and that was before anybody would give us any money to do anything. And then after Four, they gave us like the record budget. What's odd is that studios start charging you three times as much when you, oh, you're Blues Traveler now. Well, what was a $200,000 record cost $600,000, and that was us still being allowed to be us, but with a big budget. That's where the string section came in for yours, and so those two albums, I think, were where we felt limitless, because when you don't get any money, you don't realize how much you could use that money, so you feel limitless. We've got our crew guys doing our sound. I mean, it's all us. It's up to us. You feel completely free in that time, and then when you actually have that plus a budget, you feel free then too. Only after you make it, then you feel the pressure of, oh boy, we've got to have another runaround. And they kept trying to make a song runaround. I think it was To and Fro. That song vaguely sounded like Runaround, so they were really kind of pushing us to make that one into Runaround. We made a video at the that dome in Central Park, you know, what was that called? The Shell? The Shell, yeah. The band Shell, we rigged a taxi cab to hit a fire hydrant and explode and stuff, so it was kind of, we had stunts in it. And I look at that video and I was like, pretty terrible, but, you know, that was the Runaround we had to feed them. It was, those two albums were by far my favorite. Yeah.
Although, I'm thinking of the second album, the Greg Allman story, if you want to share.
Oh, there's that one.
Share that.
I keep telling that one. Greg Allman's eventually going to just come and find me and beat the shit out of me. We asked him to play, Brendan had written a song, Mountain Cry, and we asked him to play, and this is our second album, and we'd done some touring with the Allman Brothers then, and we're waiting for Greg, and what we didn't know is that Greg had used, they keep the alcohol away from him on tour with the Allman Brothers, and so his availability to come play with us, he was out of sight of his keepers, and Dave Graham, our manager, then picked him up, and we're waiting for him, and like an hour goes by, and another hour goes by, and Dave Graham calls. This is before cell phones, so you can't just call people. And he says, all right, we're almost there. He goes, let me get on the phone. Hey, John, this is Greg. We're almost there. He could tell he's had a few. And he gets there, and he's really drunk. And he's trying to play this song for me, and his hands are shaking. And that was really kind of touching, because he wanted to show me this song, and he really physically couldn't play. And I'm there like, oh my God, Greg Allman's talking to me. Like, that's how I was feeling about it. And, you know, so I'm liking anything he's playing, but there was this look in his eye where he knew he wasn't playing it well, and that was a little heartbreaking. But we get through the song, which is basically kind of House of the Rising Sun feel sort of tune. And, of course, Greg can sing it really well. And it's a good session. Our producer was Jim Gaines, who'd done a lot of work with Greg and other things, and they were talking about how crazy Johnny Cash is or was, and Greg takes me aside and goes, John, I want 10% of this album. Greg Allman's talking to me. And so I say, you know, I look into, I'll talk to the guys. There you go. There's guys I've got to talk to. And he goes, all right, great. And by the way, we're playing up in the Lone Star Roadhouse. This is up on 52nd Street. And Rick Danko invited me to go sit in with him and come play with us. I was like, wow, cool. Of course I'll be there. And I show up, and Greg is doing a couple numbers with the opening band. And I go backstage, and Rick Danko has taken some drug that's making him go, ah! I'll never forget the noise. And he won't stop doing it. And so we're going to give Rick a few minutes to get out there, get himself together. And so Greg enlists the opening band and me and plays a couple of songs. And you know what Greg's thinking, because after a few songs, he's like, I'll go see what's keeping Rick. And so that means bye, Greg. We're not going to see Greg anymore. He wanted whatever Rick was having. So Rick Danko and friends became me and the opening band for the rest of the night. And I go upstairs, and there's Greg and Rick howling at the moon. And he goes, hey, John, how'd it go? All right, come here, come here. I was thinking about it. I want 20% of that record. And I'm like, well, I'll talk to the guys. He goes, look, don't talk to the guys. You just do it. And we don't work that way. You know, I'm trying to make a plea for democracy now. And he goes, you know I wrote that song. And so now I'm like cornered with a direct question. And I had to go, well, no. And he goes, oh. And then I looked into the phrase that saved my butt. And I meant it, but I said, you're breaking my heart. And he goes, oh, man, you know what? I don't need any money. Forget the whole thing, man. And he hugs me. And this was my introduction to Greg Allman. Like, he once got into a drunken fight with Chan, my guitar player, who's equally drunk, because he wanted to join Blues Traveler. They're at a bar, and he's like, I want to join your band. And Chan's drunk enough to go, no, dude, you totally can't. You know? So this grapple of two intellectual giants, I really wish I'd been there for. But, you know, that was Greg. I will tell you this about Greg. Do not ever, ever play cards with him when he's had a few. We had an end of the tour card game, and you're thinking, wow, this is cool. It's like playing with Wild Bill Hickok or something. I was up $200. I'm ready to leave. Greg is like, you know, listing, like so intoxicated. He's not even seeing straight. John, come on, play. I'm thinking, well, I mean, I can't pass. This is Greg Allman. Oh, my God, I'm playing cards with Greg Allman. He did Jacks Are Better to open, which is a really hard rule to under, but before I knew it, I was down $200 in a matter of moments. So just do not play him cards ever. But yeah, that was the quickest ass whooping I ever got. Yeah, he's amazing, and you can't tell what state, you know, he's got a lot of faces, but you know, he's Greg Allman. He's got that Billie Holiday thing. You can never really get mad at Greg. You just must be wary.
Fair enough. Any another question? For John?
Yeah, there we go. Well, go ahead.
Sure, one, go ahead.
What was the inspiration?
I saw the Jane Goodall special on HBO about the chimpanzees. And what she noted is that the reason that scientists like to use chimpanzees is that they suffer just like human children do, which to me made me think, well, isn't that the reason not to torture chimpanzees? And so that line became the whole idea of, whoops, we get to torture chimpanzee and infect them with disease because they scream just like a human child as we study their desperate pleas. And that kind of became the foundation of the rest of that song. And, you know, it didn't occur to me that we don't write many environmental songs. That one just seemed to kind of write itself. It was a kind of an easy concept once I went there. God, see, that was off of a Save His Soul. That album to me was, again, like our most natural album. And, you know, with the new band, I would say, you know, with Tad and Ben, I would say Truth Be Told was probably our most natural album. And, you know, then we were trying to find somewhere to go. And I think it really wasn't until Susie Cracks the Whip, when we started working with other writers, that the guys really got to, you know, expound on what they're good at. You know, and that's the thing. I think the adjustment Blues Traveler makes now is that our bass player is a real technical virtuoso. And we have a keyboard player who can take our harmonies a whole bunch of different places. Patrick Clifford, who signed us in the old days, heard us in our new incarnation and said, oh, you guys went jazz. And I could see what he means, because we were a lot rougher sounding in the old days. But I think that was the only place. I don't mind being in that category as long as you just don't need a pipe and elbow patches to come hear us. You know, I think that something that Bill Graham used to always say is that good music is pelvic music. It's stuff that makes you want to dance. And to that end, you go to a bar and you try to hit on people and get loose. And you need music to that with a beat that makes you move. And that's really what we're always after. And if that's jazz, cool. If that's rock, cool. If that's funk. I was talking to someone the other day. Every time you have a new band and you ask them what their genre is, they always throw in as many genres as they can. It's sort of a funk, jazz, rock, blues thing with a little folk in it and some coffee house. And, you know, so like you really don't know then what kind it is. And that's, I'd always like be cute and go, it's ours. You know, and that's kind of an easier way to do it. But yeah, God, I love the way we used to play, and I love the way we play. If we tried to play the way we used to play, it would be completely artificial. You know, we are older. You can't pretend to go back, and you can't pretend to be ignorant. And there's some really beautiful ignorance when you're young, and you can't ever do that. But on the other side, I remember when we were young and opening for the Neville brothers. That was when we first signed with Bill Graham, and we watched, I think it was Art Neville, with just a cowbell, you know. I think we're all thinking of needs more cowbell. This guy ran the room with a cowbell. It was as if he had planted his feet and the entire room was swinging on his 2 feet. And with a cowbell, and that's an authority that you have when you're older that you can't do when you're younger. So you're really kind of trading off between this wonderful, furious ignorance and this command that you eventually take. And I always use the analogy of the calf and the bull. You know, the calf says, hey, Dad, let's run down and fuck one of those heifers. And the dad says, no, son, let's walk down and fuck them all. And you can't do that when you're young. You don't have that confidence. And when you're old, why the hell not? I can't run anyway. And so that's my 2 cents on that one, I guess. Yeah.
Question. A couple things. One is earlier on in the career of Blues Traveler, you opened up, you actually sat in for a bit.
Yeah.
Early on. Tell us about how that came about. Earlier on. And then what was that like?
Yeah, that was an amazing day and a terrible day because it was Bill Graham's memorial, and it was at Golden Gate Park, and that was the last place I'd seen Bill alive, and it happened to be on the day that Miles Davis died. And on that day, we had Carlos Santana come up and play a 20-minute version of Mountain Cry, and that's actually on some EP, I think On Tour Forever, off of with Travelers and Thieves. It was like an extended EP, and that felt to us, that playing with Santana was such a special moment. It felt like a graduation to us. Before that, we felt like goofy kids, but Santana was up there taking us seriously. He traded solos with me, he traded solos with Chan, and we gave as good as we got and treated him like contemporary, you know, to the extent that we could. It was the first time we weren't like, oh my God, it's Santana. I mean, we were creaming in our jeans, but we were also really like we're supposed to be there. We felt like we were supposed to be there, and it was this huge moment. And I remember thanking Bill, who clearly orchestrated this, because Santana, you know, he'd manage Santana forever. We wouldn't be playing in Golden Gate Park if it wasn't for Bill. And he said, yeah, I remember when Santana was playing with Muddy Waters and how he felt exactly like this. And, you know, his point was that this is a long string of these things. And we'd always tried to get me sitting with the dead, but we'd open for Jerry Garcia a few times. They referred to us as like heavy metal, actually. You know, none of that metal stuff, you guys. That's what their crew would always say to us. And we'd always be like, metal, wait, do they know which band we are? Like, that's how we thought. When we heard Bill had played our demo for Jerry, he said, nice harp, and we dined on that forever. Did you hear that? Garcia said, nice harp. Well, Bill then passed away, you know, it was like a month later, and we're back at Golden Gate Park, and I mean, it was very surreal, and Dave had asked Jerry if I could play with them, and he said yes, and so I'm in the tent where Jerry is, and there's all these people there, and I don't know what to do. I'm terrified. It's like Moses sitting there. And he had this thing with his hair where it would move before him into a room. And you just felt like you couldn't approach or talk to him. It was a very weird aura. Like, there he is. It's almost like a light would shine down on him as he walked through. And he's just trying to eat a cheeseburger, you know? And I'm just sitting there respectfully, and then eventually the whole tent clears out, and it's him and me. And he's just, I remember the size. He's like, eating his cheeseburger, and I'm trying to think of something. I got to say something. And, you know, he's kind of amused at me playing with the little telescope I had on my harmonica belt. I used to have a harmonica belt that I would carry all of this crap on. And, like, I had a grappling hook with some line on there. I wanted to be Batman, you know, basically. And so, you know, that only goes so long to kill time. And I'm thinking of something to say, and I say, I'm a flurry of emotion. And I get... Me too. And that was the extent of our conversation. And that was it. And then I went up and I did Wang Dang Doodle with them. And I remembered when Santana played with them, he would stretch out, and the Dead, being this band that knows how to bend time and space, would implode. If you went at them aggressively, the bass and the drums would disappear from underneath you and you would find yourself falling. And so I was like, don't do that. I did my little bit and I got in and I got out. And I was not in. And I remember Dave Graham going, you should have gone for it more. And I was like, no, I'm not falling into the Santana trap. And, you know, I left and they said, nice work. And I actually got to play with Dead & Co. around Christmas. And, you know, Bill Kreutzmann, I played with Billy and the Kids. That was the night before Jordan and I got married at Locken. And that was a fun, that was way fun. And he's just such a great drummer. You forget how good they are individually. Because he just made everything this really awesome groove. It was really swinging. And he asked me up on stage, and of course, I didn't have the right key harmonica. We did Casey Jones, and so I had to do a really major version, but it still worked out. You know, just get up there and make what you can out of it. And I'm looking forward to playing with those guys again. You know, I think when the Dead was there, there's so much, when Jerry was there, there's so much reverence, and I don't know, maybe just because I'm older, I just feel like, you know, I want to go and stretch out with them. I think Trey playing with them really makes me feel a little more confident about playing with those guys. There, it was such, you know, a reverence. You know, we would enshrine them, and it made them hard to approach. And I remember at the New School, going to a jazz school, it was really easy for me. Arnie Lawrence used to call the rock and roll oriented musicians the dummies, but he meant that as a badge of honor because we didn't know anything. So when Chico Hamilton would come up to you, the people that knew Chico Hamilton would be like, oh my God, Chico Hamilton's talking to me. As a jazz kid, you're freaking out. I had no idea who he was, so I could play with him and we could actually talk. And I think that we had our own version of that with the Grateful Dead. I think it was tough to just relax. And, you know, even now I'll fangirl about anything. You know, I'll meet, you know, Bill Murray, I still always feel it's in the book. A few times I hang out with Bill and I feel like, am I saying something funny? Am I being too funny? Does he need a rest? Does he need a soda? You know, I kind of just chill out and, like, you know, he's right there. He's fine. He got himself to the show. He's okay. And, you know, I think it's taken me, I'm almost 50 now, and it's taken me that long to finally just relax and let people do their thing. I know Peter still hasn't relaxed. He wants to get me a soda right now, I can tell. Look at him. Yeah, that's it. I'm on to you. Anybody else? No? Well, I'll sign anything you guys want.
Cool.
And I'd like to get a hand for this gentleman who's, like, he's been very patient. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. iPhones are necessary.
Yeah, absolutely. And thanks for letting me do this. This is really kind of a cool honor. I mean, this is the Strand. Just like that was Greg Allman, this is the Strand. Thanks, you guys.